And welcome back to part two of our three session series of Lunch and Learn with Dr. Ted Merwin, a senior writer for the Jewish Federations of North America. Before coming to JFNA, he worked at APEX Synagogue Initiative, director for the Mid-Atlantic region. For many years, he taught Judaic studies at Dickinson College in Carlisle, PA, where he was the founding director of the Milton B. Aspel Center for Jewish Life. Today, Dr. Merwin will continue his discussion on how the basic needs of human existence became central themes to Jewish comedy. And welcome, Dr. Merwin.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So good to be back. Really enjoyed our session last week, and I can't wait to dive into the material for today and also for next week, which I've been working to prepare. But I guess, first of all, I just wanted to ask, you know, just let's think a minute about clothing, which is going to be the subject of today's class. And why do we wear clothing? If people want to put in the chat, what are the basic functions of clothing? You have any ideas? Why do we wear it?
And feel free to unmute yourselves when
you
have an answer.
If you can unmute yourself, you can answer that way.
Oh, hi. Anita Eidenberg. We wear clothing to keep us warm.
Good.
Is one reason. Some people wear clothing for modesty.
I think we all wear clothing for modesty to a certain extent. So I think you're right on both counts. I think we wear it to protect ourselves from the elements. I think that we wear it to cover up the parts of our bodies that we don't necessarily want to be shown, or that our society says shouldn't be shown.
We also wear clothing to identify ourselves. Mm. Our clothing tells people who we are. Mm-hmm.
Yes, it expresses our personality. Actually, and sometimes it occurs to me that it shows us as members of a particular group, right? I mean, actually, you know, sometimes we want to wear something different to sort of showcase certain aspects of ourselves. And sometimes we wear exactly the same thing as everyone else. What would be an example of that, of when we want it, when we actually wear the same thing? Everyone's wearing the same thing. Anita, what's it?
Yom Kippur.
In a Jewish context, yeah, I mean, you could say, a yarmulke, a tallit, you know, a prayer shawl, something like that. But even just in the rest of our society, you know, what kinds of uniforms do people wear, you know, when they go to war, when they go to work, you know, to show that when they go to school, some schools have uniforms and everyone needs to wear them. And supposedly that helps with discipline and things like that. So when you're in a professional athlete, you definitely have to dress the same so everybody knows which team people are on and things like that. So thank you so much, Anita. That's really helpful. You know, these are the reasons why we wear clothing. Now let's think about this in a Jewish context, which you've already kind of introduced us to. But we've talked about, you know, ritual garb, which is really important in terms of going to synagogue and praying together and showing that we're all part of a community and we're all approaching God in the same spirit and so on and so forth. But I think way beyond even just the religious, I mean, we're going to be talking today and throughout this series mostly about Jewish culture rather than Jewish religion. And I'm just curious, I mean, I don't think anyone's going to give me an argument if I say that Jews have had a very long-standing relationship with different aspects of clothing manufacture and design and so on and so forth. And I'm just wondering, does anyone on this call have any experience professionally or any family members, parents, grandparents, uncles, aunts who worked in any way in the clothing industry? I'm looking at the chat. But if anyone wants to unmute and just want to say what your family connection is to the clothing business, then whether it be wholesale or retail or manufacturing or whatever, anybody have any connection to that? Steven?
Yeah, my grandfather was made dresses.
Okay. Where, in what city?
New York.
New York, okay. So he worked in the garment industry, in the garment district, I mean, okay.
Yes.
Anyone else? Thank you. Anyone else? Judy, you're on mute, so you have to unmute yourself first.
My uncle was a rag man.
Okay.
And that was the very, very beginning of the recycling of the rags mm-hmm. that would blatten made into clothes.
Yeah, they were all called, in London, they were called old clothes vendors, or I guess in New York too, they were like the shmata trade right. or something like that, right?
Right.
And yes, and Jews went into that. They went into junk dealing. They went into all kinds of things that, I'm really interested in that actually. They went into all kinds of things that had to do with, as you say, sort of recycling the things that other people no longer wanted or weren't useful anymore and making them into something new. So thank you. That's actually really great as well. Anyone else? Okay, well, let's get started. I was thinking since last week, since this series is on, you know, the bare necessities of life and as a theme in Jewish comedy, and I was thinking about right from the beginning, to get back to, we were just talking for a moment with Anita about the about Jewish religion in particular. From the very invention. I don't know if invention's the right word. I guess it might be the right word. From the very creation of humankind in the book of Genesis, right? What is it that that Adam and Eve have a challenge with, you know, in terms of the bare necessities of life, right? So we're talking about food, clothing, and shelter in this series. So right from the get-go, they eat the wrong food, right? They discover that they're wearing the wrong thing, or actually they're wearing nothing, which becomes problematic to them. And they realize they have to cover up. And they get kicked out of their home. So they're essentially homeless, right? I mean, they weren't living in a building. They were just living in the Garden of Eden, but still, right? So it's interesting to think about how these were right from the beginning of the human race, you know, of our species, how these were, you know, really, it was a problem to get access to these things. So I actually used to teach a course on this when I was a college professor. I taught a course on Jews and food, and I taught a course on Jews and clothing, or actually I called it Jews and fashion. And it actually did start with the story of Adam and Eve, and sort of went through the Talmud and went through all through the Middle Ages. I don't know if you've seen any of the they have some wonderful medieval manuscripts, you know, beautiful, colorful, illustrated manuscripts in the museum in Jerusalem, the Israel Museum in Jerusalem. And I don't know if you've seen pictures of these, like, they look like oil can hats that the Jews are wearing in the medieval period. That, you know, Jews had to wear, you know, badges and special clothing to show that they were Jewish, and they were discriminated against on that basis. Obviously that happens, you know, later in the Holocaust as well. And all through history, up until the Jews and the garment business, as we mentioned, on the Lower East Side of New York, and how so many Jews sort of graduated in a way from working in making clothes to becoming some of the greatest fashion designers in our society. You know, I mean, it's funny, I was listening to a Jackie Mason clip last night. He's one of my favorite comedians, and he has a funny routine that you may have heard about, where he says that, you know, like, Jews always want to wear clothes that are made by French designers. You know, he goes into this whole thing about Yves Saint Laurent and Yves Saint Laurent. And it's actually not true. You know, I mean, there's so many Jewish fashion designers too. Ralph Lauren, right? Someone just said, AKA Ralph Lifshitz, and Isaac Mizrahi, and Kenneth Cole, and Donna Karen. And, you know, we could go on and on in terms of, you know, Jews who became really, really successful in fashion design. But let's take a little bit of a step back, and I'm going to share my screen, and I have a PowerPoint that I put together. And so what happens, we have, you know, how did Jews sort of begin this whole relationship with clothing? One of the things that I should say before I begin is that I got interested in this, because, as all of you know, I mean, I'm a scholar of popular culture, particularly of film and television and theater and all of that. And it struck me that, you know, there were two industries that Jews were really overwhelmingly involved with at the turn of the 20th century when they came to New York from Eastern Europe. And one of them was the clothes. They came here like right at the moment when the ready-made clothing business, particularly for women's clothing, was really taking off in the late 19th century and being mechanized for the first time. And a huge proportion of, I mean, more than half of the clothing industry was in Jewish hands. And at the same time, the other industry that Jews were, you know, extremely active in was the entertainment industry. And supposedly more than half of the entertainment business was also in Jewish hands at the turn of the 20th century. But what I realized when I first started doing the research on this is that those two things had never really been put together in terms of looking specifically at the way in which clothing was reflected in Jewish culture, Jewish comedy in particular. And so that's what I'm going to be focusing on to a large extent today. And I think while we're talking about that, I think we want to think a lot about, you know, the importance of clothing in identity. You know, what, and we've started talking about this already, right? What is it about the clothing that we wear? How does it really show the way that we feel about ourselves, you know, and sort of show to the world the way that we, you know, our personality and, you know, maybe some of the conflicts that we have. And there were a lot of conflicts that Jews had that they used clothing as a way of sort of trying to deal with, you know. I mean, coming to America and, you know, you may have heard those stories, which I think are somewhat apocryphal about, you know, as soon as Jews are coming into the harbor, you know, past the Statue of Liberty in New York, that they, you know, throw their prayer shawls and their tefillin and stuff like that overboard because I'm going to be a new person, right? And a lot of people felt that way, you know, that they would buy, you know, a new dress or a new suit or something like that. And it was as if they were a new person. They really felt that they were becoming American in, you know, by simply changing their clothes, shaving their beards, you know, that kind of thing. And there's a wonderful novel that you may have heard of. If you haven't read it, I really recommend it, called The Rise of David Levinsky by Abraham Kahan. It's sort of a staple of American literature courses in colleges and universities. And it's all about someone who comes from Eastern Europe and shaves his beard and changes his clothes and thinks that he's going to become, you know, and he actually becomes very successful as a clothing manufacturer. So it's all about the history of Jews and clothing on the Lower East Side. But he loses his soul, you know, kind of in the process, and exploits his workers, you know, and things like that. And, you know, most of these clothing factories had actually been started by German Jewish or Central European Jewish immigrants who had come earlier, you know, in the middle of the 19th century. And, you know, and then the Eastern European Jews came at the end of the 19th century, and there was a lot of conflict between them in terms of, you know, sort of looking down on these people who were going to give all Jews a bad name and get them sort of tarred with the same brush in the eyes of the majority society, because the Jewish newcomers, the immigrants, and I think we talked about this a little bit last time in the context of the Seinfeld episode that we discussed when they're waiting in line for the Chinese restaurant and no one will let them into that, they can't get into the Chinese restaurant, right? Being outsiders, right? And being not knowing English and not knowing the customs and so on and so forth. And it's true. I mean, they came, here's a picture of a garment factory on the Lower East Side. And, you know, I mean, this was the Golden of Medina, right? This was supposed to be the place of you know, instant wealth and success and everything like that. And you know, compared to the experience they'd had in Eastern Europe, I think I'm actually going to start next week's session by playing Zero Mustel in If I Were a Rich Man from Fiddler on the Roof, in terms of the dream of, you know, what life could be like, you know. And they came to America wanting to fulfill those dreams. And what happens? You know, they end up living in terribly squalid conditions, right? In overcrowded tenements, with a lot of disease and you know, a lot of, you know, exploitation in the sweatshops by these factory owners, you know, as I said, many of whom were actually Jewish, you know, Jewish as well. And, you know, I'm just thinking, I saw that movie over the weekend, The Glass Onion,
Knives Out.
Knives Out series, you know, and there's a funny comment, there's a funny line in that movie about one of the characters that started a very successful line of sweatpants, and then finds out that they're being manufactured in a sweatshop in Asia somewhere. And it turns out that, you know, she didn't know what a sweatshop was. She just thought that was a place where they made sweatpants, you know, something like that. So I'm still thinking about that because that was a kind of funny line. But it really wasn't a laughing matter. You know, I mean, the kind of life that these immigrants and their children, and mostly people, what was interesting about and different about the Jewish migration as compared to the Italian or Irish or other, is that Jews tended to come as entire families, you know, rather than sending the man first and he would work and make money and send it back and bring his family with him. So they were living in, you know, mostly as families in these terrible conditions. All right, so I'm gonna run out of time if I don't move along more quickly than this. Let me just play a quick clip.
Sweatshops, drudgery, 16 hours a day, 90 hours a week.
Nobody. We hear it. It's odd sounding a little bit, but.
Way on the schmuckers, it's rags, pinning every hope on these infernal machines.
If things are gone, each one shouts. Who let it play? Boy, my sheep. Don't see my love lies. Don't leave his wild.
Shut up in dingy tenements. They never reach the land of plenty.
Back in there,
they'd be for their children.
If he's with God, he's my spouse.
I'm going to move it along a little bit.
As this film clip depicts, art and life repeatedly mirror each other, and melodies from the Yiddish theater resonated throughout. The Yiddish stage became a collective psychodrama. Jews flocked to Second Avenue to catch plays about people like themselves.
Strikes, but the workers filled the streets with the passion of newfound freedom. These were years of Broidum theater and dry bread.
So this is exactly what I was talking about. This is actually, you know, an example of these were Yiddish films, but they were very much adaptations of what had been shown on the Yiddish stage in terms of, you know, what the life was like for these immigrants and working in these sweatshops. And this is a very famous one called Uncle Moses. I really recommend it if you haven't seen it. But this is an example of a Jewish sweatshop owner who he says, we don't need a union, right? My workers are all family. I'm using people who my landslide. They came from my homeland, you know, that the same country that I came from. And they are, you know, well treated, you know, and I don't need to pay them, you know, any more than I do and things like that. You know, this was something that, you know, was very much a staple of the popular culture of the day for the Yiddish speaking immigrants. Okay. So I want to move on quickly to I talked last time about how much changed in terms of the Jewish deli and Jewish food in the 1920s as Jews were moving out of the Lower East Side. But so much of the culture of the 20s, which is the period that I really focus on the most in my work, the second generation of Jews in America, the children of immigrants, even as Jews were moving out of the Lower East Side, even as they were moving more into the mainstream of American society, they were still very preoccupied with, almost obsessed with the Lower East Side. The Lower East Side just comes up over and over and over again in the culture of the 20s. And as we were just saying, seeing in those film clips, the 30s, because Jews are still wrestling with that. They're still wrestling with kind of, you know, they're the children of immigrants. They grew up in that immigrant culture, but they really want to be more American. They have a certain amount of shame, I guess you would say, about being Jewish at a time of tremendous anti-Semitism. 20s is the most anti-Semitic until maybe now, unfortunately, but different kind of anti-Semitism. It wasn't as violent then, but it was very pervasive in the period in between the two world wars. And so the example that I always like to share is of this very famous song that I'm sure most of you know called Secondhand Roads by Fanny Bryce. She was, she grew up on the Lower East Side. She became one of the most successful entertainers of her day. She was featured in the Ziegfeld Follies, which was the big like Radio City Music Hall kind of like reviews. And she was really in many ways, you know, one of the first celebrities, I would guess you would say, because starting in the 20s is really when we have the rise of this celebrity culture for the first time with fan magazines and You know, if they'd have websites, then they all would have had their own websites and whatever. But in those days, you know, they became popular. And so I think this song is very, very revealing. It's also very interesting that, you know, she sings it with a Yiddish accent, even though she said she didn't grow up speaking Yiddish, that her parents spoke. One was from, I think, Hungary. One was from Romania. And they spoke those languages, but they actually didn't speak Yiddish, which would be unusual for that time. But she adopts a Yiddish accent for this song. And I want to play, I want to make sure that my, my music must be, you heard the other one, right? You could hear the, did you hear the sound on the other one or did you only hear?
We did. It wasn't, it was a little warbly, but we heard it.
Oh, so that's weird. All right. I don't know if I was, okay, let's try this.
This is better.
I was looking at the rabbi's thing and it distracted me for 1 second.
Sorry.
No, it's okay.
My grandfather said poils like that.
Really?
Poils.
Right. Hopefully this is right. We were asked. Hear me still?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So let's talk about this song for a little bit. And I'm going to need some, I'm going to ask you to give your impressions of it, you know, and your ideas and your thoughts about it. First of all, one of the things that's, you know, I always see whenever I do this talk in person is that there's a certain point, I think it's at the beginning of the first chorus, when everyone in the audience starts to sing along. Unfortunately, it's funny, you know, but it's like it becomes a sing-along, you know, which I always thought was great. But All right. So who is singing this? Who's the character who's singing this song? So Fanny Brice is adopting this persona. As I mentioned, you know, she adopts this very heavy Yiddish accent. She's clearly singing about the Lower East Side experience. Second Avenue, right, was the heart of the Lower East Side. And but she's not happy, right? This is not, you know, she's not portraying herself as somebody who is really enjoying her life, right? And why is she not enjoying her life? Anybody? Unmute.
Everything is secondhand.
And what's the problem with that? I mean, what's the problem with that? Why is that a problem, do you think, for her? I mean, I'm sure, did any of you grow up like inheriting clothes from older siblings or other people in the neighborhood or whatever? Nope, nobody did? Okay.
Well, now it's funny. It's hot now. Like, my daughter and my son really only like to thrift. Even though I buy them new stuff, they like get, they prefer reusing stuff.
Yeah, well, that's partly, I guess, a concern about the environment and things like that. I know my daughters go to this place called Uptown Cheapskate, I think it's called, in Baltimore. I don't know if they have that in Florida. But so, yeah, I mean, she somehow feels like she's, you know, like not, she doesn't have a lot of self-esteem, right? And maybe it's her father's fault. I don't know, right? From the beginning, father has a business. It's almost like the father has made it his business to, you know, to humiliate her. I mean, he can't provide her with anything that makes her feel good about herself, because everything, it's not just her clothes, as Stephen pointed out, it's everything that she owns, right? Toothpicks? Who would want secondhand toothpicks? That's ridiculous, you know? She says, I feel abused, right? That's why I'm pointing this out. Is she abused, you know? And she's got some pretty nice things, right? I mean, think about it. Like the baby grand piano? I mean, yeah, it's secondhand, but still, I mean, think about what the piano symbolize for Jewish immigrants on the Lower East Side, not just for Jews and not just even for Americans, but think about the piano as in, you know, as sort of a symbol of middle-class respectability, both in Victorian America and in Victorian England, right? Where people would sit around in the parlor. And by the way, the fact that she has a parlor is kind of interesting too, right? I guess the apartments all had parlors. We can talk about that next week when we talk about, if any of you have been to Lower East Side Tenement Museum and been inside some of those actual apartments, right? But I don't know. She's, you know, she's got pearls. She's got rings. She's got jewelry, right? She's got all this jewelry. And yet somehow, right? It's, I mean, and it makes sense, right? I mean, to nothing be your own. I mean, even her pajamas, as someone, like, who would want to wear someone else's pajamas? Like, you know, even her boyfriend, right? I know it's said in this version, there are different versions of the lyrics. It's interesting to look at different versions, right? Even Jakey Cohen, right, was, I think, the way that she sang it. But whichever, right? Even Jake the Plumber is secondhand, buried in the past, right? Now, what's, I think, really interesting about that is, what does it mean for her to be secondhand, Rose? What does it mean? It's one thing for a man to be secondhand. He's had other girlfriends. But what is it for a woman to be secondhand? Doesn't it imply that she's not exactly a virgin anymore? Right? I mean, there's an interesting implicit sort of thing here about her sexuality. But
used too.
Yeah, yeah. So she feels herself, you know, like a second-class citizen, I guess you would say, right? And that's not going to feel good. And that was the dominant, I think, feeling of a lot of Jewish immigrants at this time. You know, as I mentioned, it's interesting. This is already like, you know, the next period, right? I mean, when Jews are already becoming more accepted, but they're not accepted yet. And they still carry along with them these feelings of shame and humiliation, right? Which is exactly what happens at the end of the song, right? So what's happening at the end of the song? She's strolling. Right. So what's the Ritz, obviously? It's a fancy hotel. Right, in Manhattan. And so strolling through the Ritz means she can't afford to stay at the Ritz, right? So it's the lobby of the Ritz. And it doesn't say she was walking in there or she was sitting around in there. She was strolling. What does it mean to stroll? How does strolling differ from walking?
What's the Yiddish word? I can't remember.
She was prance, strutting about in her fur coat.
Yeah, she was as much seeing, as much wanting to be seen as she was sort of checking out the scene, right? I think in there's this famous book about the flaneur in Paris, a similar kind of thing. Somebody who wants to see all the sights and whatever, but she wants to be seen at the same time, right? And what happens in that moment when she's feeling like she's on display, right? And she's strutting around, as you put it, which is a very good word. She's sort of unmasked, right? As being a pretender, she doesn't really fit there. She doesn't belong there, right? Because somebody's looking at her and laughing at her and saying, oh, she's wearing a fur coat, but that's last year's fur coat. You know, that looks like my old fur coat, you know, that nobody would wear anymore if they had any sense of fashion kind of thing, right? And so again, right. I mean, what could be more painful than that, right? Right in the moment when you're really feeling good about yourself, you get taken down a peg and you get shown that you actually don't know anything about, you know, the kinds of clothes that people are supposed to wear.
So look, it's a cute song and it's, we get the, it's a, you know, a low self-esteem, everything's happening. Because I can remember as a child, it's not so new now. Mm-hmm. We traded clothes around like crazy and loved it.
Mm-hmm.
And older cousins, we were certainly, our parents could afford to buy new, that wasn't the issue, but we all did that. And I certainly did it with my children.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, it was a, just a quick story. All the kids were in camp, going to Camp Coleman,
mm-hmm.
My children and just all the kids from here that were going. And unfortunately, my problem was that my kids were just tall. They were big.
Mm-hmm.
And none of the others were. So we were always the ones giving everything away. So one of the women said to me, she's packing up the trunk. She says, every name had Cotler in it, you know, because I just put name tags and everything.
Mm-hmm.
She says, all their clothes have Cotler in it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's it was cute. But we used to love that secondhand thing.
That's right. All right, so we need to move on. But yes, this was a song that Barbara Streisand ended up, you know, making famous. And, you know, I think it's worth pointing out that who wrote the song? Two Irish-American,
yeah.
Composers, whatever, composer and lyricist. And so this was something universal about this experience. And I think that's why this became, I think without exaggeration, one of the most popular songs of the 20th century, because it spoke to something that, you know, it struck a chord, you know, let's say, and, you know, for a lot of people. All right, so let's sort of bracket this a little bit in terms of, you know, the way that clothing kind of really, you know, served some very complicated functions. And I think it still does. I'm going to play just a little bit of this for any Eddie Cantor fans in the audience. Eddie Cantor is kind of forgotten nowadays, almost, or becoming forgotten, unfortunately. And he was one of the greats from the same period, from the Ziegfeld Follies and all that. And this is from the Ziegfeld Follies. This this was done in the Ziegfeld Follies, also in the 1920s. And it's about Eddie Cantor is playing a very high pressure salesman in a used clothing store on the Lower East Side. And this was true. I mean, I've read articles in the New York Times from that period about they would have, I think they called them pullers in or something. They would literally go out on the sidewalk and they would drag people into the store and they would do everything that they could possibly do to sell them, clothes. This was called, usually called a belt in the back, but now they're calling it Joe's Blue Front for whatever reason. All right, let's go.
Your Honor, you've got the finest suit in the whole place. Mo, and you got that package wrapped up yet?
Go ahead, kill me. Go ahead, kill me. Hey, my dear man, I want to tell you something. That's the best suit of clothes we got in the whole house. You won't be able to wear that suit out. You'll be ashamed. I'm telling you.
You've got the finest suit of clothes in the whole
place. Oh, don't listen to him. He's a damn fool. Go ahead.
But I'm telling you, you've got the finest suit in the whole place.
Come in again. Come in again sometime.
Goodbye. Mo, listen to me, Mo. Don't you tell anyone that I am a damn fool. Don't you ever tell anyone that I am a damn fool.
I didn't know it was a secret.
All right, let's move on. This short, squeaky voice guy.
Hey, you got quite a billing, huh?
I should say so.
I want to tell you something, my dear man. That's the best suit of clothes we got in the whole
house. What's the matter with you? What's the matter with you?
What's the matter?
It's the man's own suit.
Go ahead, kill me. Go ahead.
I think of your hat and coat, my friend.
All right, now they're going to try to sell him whatever.
Are you a sport? Yeah. You play casino? You take the suit? And we'll send you home in a taxi cab, all right? Call him a taxi cab, all right?
I want a belt in the back.
All right, I'll fix you.
You're going to get a belt.
I hear something very lovely. Here's a very lovely spectacle. Here's a suit that only the gentlemen and the whole people is wearing. Yes, of course, the buttons don't meet, but... I
don't think they've ever been introduced.
Don't tell jokes. Do you see what this suit is? It's the latest Palm Beach model. All the people is going to wear two-button sack suits this season.
No, I like a one-button.
One button? We're here to please you, my dear man. That's all that you are. How do you like that?
Too tight for me.
Too tight. That's all you got to do is to tell me. Turn around. Sure. Go ahead. Huh? Now, take a walk. How does that feel?
It's all right, but a little cold in the back.
Cool. That's what you call the cooling system. That's the new Frigidaire. With a suit like this, you couldn't get hot under the collar. You see what I mean?
All right, so they keep trying to sell them different suits that are more ridiculous.
Let's take suits here. You want patch pockets? You want patch pockets? Pockets? You want patch? Patch pockets. You want patch?
Patch.
You want patch? Give them patch. All right, you'll get patch. You'll get patch. Give them patch there.
Patch pockets.
Well, how do you like that?
How much is it?
Take a look at the bag there.
T.O.T.
$26.50.
That's too much.
$26.50. Let me explain to you. The suit cost us alone wholesale $24. We are paying rent here a year, $1,075. It cost us for gas and for electricity every month, $35. We are paying the police protection. They shouldn't break the windows, $25. Last winter, my wife was sick. What did it cost me?
$320?
I'll charge you $15. Here, add it up. What could be making profit on a suit like that?
Maybe I don't have to have a text.
That's what I'm telling you. You don't have to have it. He's intelligent. I could tell by his...
All right, we'll keep going. We don't have a lot of time.
Wait a minute. Here is a hat that goes with that suit. How do you like that hat? Good?
Yeah, that's too big for me.
Give me a hand. Give me a hand. What's too big about it? I'm telling you, for 2 years, you could wear that hat. Take a walk. For 2 years, my dear man, you could wear that hat.
Yeah, but my hand will get tired.
You change your hand. You change your hand. You've got to tell them everything. Well, how do you like it?
Well, I'll take the hat.
And the coat.
No.
And the coat.
No.
Yeah, listen, they've been together for 2 years. Why should you separate the hat and the coat?
No, I'll take the hat, but I want to look in the mirror.
Why should you look in the mirror and get discouraged?
Can't you take my word for it?
Would he lie to you? We're not in business for that. Well, how do you like that? Well, my dear, let me tell you something. When you're wearing a suit like that, you will be the talk of the town. I'm telling you. You could go to a baseball game, and you start up, and you get up, and you holler, "Hooray for Babe Ruthie! Knock a home run!" And the people are sitting around and say, "Who's that fresh man?" And they see you and say, "Ah, he's not fresh. He's wearing a Kuppenheimer coat." You see what I mean? You go to a dance at night. You're coming up to a woman and say, "Pardon me, could I have the next waltz with you, if you please?" And she says, "He's too short." "Ah, but he's a Kuppenheimer. So if you wear a Kuppenheimer clothes, you can't go wrong." I'll tell you something. In Washington, in the inauguration, what do you think Coolidge is saying to Hoover?
"I want a Batman."
All right, so I'm going to stop there. But I think this is also very interesting, right? It's about how he's going to really be transformed into a real American, you know, who's going to be able to go to the baseball games and yell, "Hooray for Babe Ruth, he hit a home run," whatever, or to the inauguration in Washington. And somehow, you know, this short, you know, like squeaky Jewish guy is going to, not Jewish guy, we don't know if he's Jewish, he could be a farmer from whatever. But the idea, right, is that these Jewish clothing salesmen are going to take these ridiculous used clothes, and somehow out of that, it's like this whole thing that Anita was talking about recycling or whatever, right? And his identity is going to be sort of transformed in some way. And that was the dream, that was the aspiration, that was Fanny Bryce's issue, right? And that's his issue as well, you know, but in a more masculine kind of framework. All right, so let's keep moving. I'm just going to play. So this is actually a very, very famous song from, it's called Sing Me a Song with Social Significance, 1930s Garment Review, International Ladies Garment Workers Union Review that ran on Broadway, actually was the longest running show until Oklahoma, believe it or not. And it was all about, you know, we were already talking about the labor industry and so the garment industry, you know, strikes and things like that.
I'm tired of moon songs, of star and of June songs, they simply make me nap. And ditties romantic drive me nearly frantic, I think they're all full of pap. History's making, nations are quaking, why sing of stars above? For while we are waiting, Father Time's creating new things to be singing. significance. All other tunes are taboo. I want a ditty with heat in it, appealing with feeling and meat in it. Sing me a song with social significance, or you can sing till you're blue.
All right, we don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to keep moving. But yeah, this was the way that a lot of people really got a lot of meaning in their lives, was through, you know, standing up to oppression and injustice. And you know, I mean, we know this. I mean, particularly, you know, in a Reformed Jewish context, this was the way that a lot of, you know, Jews in particular started to develop that consciousness of social justice, was through the labor movement. Very, very important, right? All right, I want to get back to something that's more comedic, explicitly comedic, which is the Spartan Brothers song. This is from the Yiddish Radio Project, and it's one of my favorites. It's about it's in Yiddish, but we can translate it. But it's about a very important rite of passage for a boy, not just to have a bar mitzvah, but to buy a suit for his bar mitzvah. I don't know if anybody remembers being taken by their parents to buy a bar mitzvah suit or a bat mitzvah dress or something like that. But, you know, I think very memorable in a lot of people's childhoods.
W-B-V-D.
Hey, Bob, Bariba.
Yeah, bye, yabba, bye, yabba, bye, bye, bye. W-B-V-D.
Oi, send me sister.
Yeah, bye, yabba, bye, 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 yabba, bye, 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 bye. Every Sunday morning over WBD.
Joe wants a bargain egging. Joe wants me can a bargain egging. A suit a coit a gabardine. Bring that on a kleinem zin.
Caught speech.
I give for your morgen eich, meine liebe Radio Zuhörers. Wir bringen jetzt das Programm von John Pauls bis auf drei Stores. Der erste Store ist located in Stendalency in downtown Manhattan. Der zweite Store ist located in Hunts Point, Southern Boulevard in the Bronx. Und der dritte Store ist located in Pitkin Avenue, Bronzeville, Brooklyn. Heute hier aber mit für Ingelow ist auf oben ein Slecksuit, ein Two-Tone, ein Reweißable Slick, ein Herringbein, ein Jacket, ein Behäusen, ein Miami Sherbet, ein Bronx Sharpie, ein Brooklyn Troop. Bringt ihr mal rein, sie.
God, speech.
Mames, heute ihr ein jünger Boy in der Heim, ein 14, 15 Jahre alt, muss die 18 zu sein, ein Boy Lesho. Er kauft schon French Postelkarts. Er kommt daheim, geht daran in der Bathroom, macht sie die Tiere, macht sie noch. Mames, tiet mir ein Teufel und geht dem Boy ein Putuler. Ihn schickt ihm rein zu Kakai Jenny. In der Tama weißt du nicht, wie das ist. Es fragt ein Mann, er kennt schon das Platz, sehr ihr geht.
Joe, wants a bargain. Joe, wants we can a bargain.
So I think you get the point. Does anyone want to... I
just don't think you could call anyone cockeyed Jenny today. I mean, it's so on PC, but I love the, it was so inappropriate. I'd order the album cover because it's so cool looking. Like it is such a vibe of the, but it's so bad. Like the, so on PC.
The boy, you know, coming of age, and so much of it is connected to, you know, the clothes that he wears and all the different, I love the list of all the different kinds of suits, you know, that were available in the three stores in Manhattan, Bronx, and Brooklyn. And, you know, I mean, that's an important part of coming of age, right? Is the, you know, he's an adolescent with hormones and whatever. So, yeah, no, I think it's really interesting. All right, let's keep moving. Barbara Streisand also, this is another, this was actually her debut, I think, in the 60s in the musical I Can Get It For You Wholesale. Just play a few, but... you know, I mean, it's interesting how the sort of the center of gravity has shifted from Second Avenue of Manhattan to Seventh Avenue in the 30s, where the garment industry, you know, had sort of moved up from the Lower East Side, the wholesalers at any rate, which you still have to a certain extent on some of those streets in the 30s. And there were Jewish cafeterias that catered to them, which gets into the whole Jewish food thing. But this was, really something that was in many ways at the center of American popular culture was these representations of, the relationship between Jews and clothing. And, it's interesting in Neil Gabler's book, How the Jews Invented an Empire of Their Own, how the Jews Invented Hollywood. You know, he sort of makes the case that one of the reasons why Jews became so successful in the movie business was because they had sort of learned to have their finger on, the changes in popular taste that came from clothing and other things, right? So that they really were able to kind of create a whole new industry that spoke to the dreams and aspirations of America, of all Americans. All right, so since we're staying with Barbra Streisand a little bit, just very quickly, Sam, you may know this song, Sam, You Made the Pants Too Long.
Trousers dragging, slowly dragging through the street. Yes, I'm walking, but I'm walking without feet. What's too big and what's too small? But Sam, Sam, you promised me both ends would meet. You made the coat and vest fit the best. You made the lining nice and strong. But Sam, you made the pants too long.
All right. So, it's funny what that song always makes me think of is, the old joke that connects so much to the Eddie Cantor also, right? To the fact that these suits never fit the guy and whatever. But it reminds me of the joke about the guy who goes to the tailor and, and he says, I need you to make me a suit. And he makes him a suit and he comes back and he puts it on and he says, one of the sleeves is way too long. It's much longer than the other one. And he says, well, that's not a big deal. You could just take the one that's too long and you could sort of push it up a little bit and kind of hike up your shoulder. And he says, but then the pants are also they're completely uneven. He's like, well, you could sort of hike up on one side on your hip, and you could, sort of walk around like that. And, he keeps telling him that he has to keep changing his posture and his body and whatever, and twisting up in all kinds of crazy ways. But he convinces him that, if he does that, then the suit will look great. And the guy walks out the door and he's walking down the street and he doesn't get halfway down the street before someone stops him and says, whoa, is that a new suit? And he said, yeah, I just got a new suit. And he said, can you give me the name of your tailor? And the guy's like, wow, you want the name of my tailor? That he's such a great tailor. And he says, yeah, he must be a great tailor because anybody could fit somebody who is misshapen and hunchback or whatever as you are must be a genius kind of thing. I just also want to play, I know we have probably a lot of Mickey Katz fans in the Zoom, so let me just play this quickly.
I look, I'm worried and fablonjet. My bathrobe is here, but where is my pants? The closet is full with ties and pajamas. My cufflinks are there, but where is my pants? It's so hard to realize that you don't put things on a place. I could wear a fancy coat, but without pants, bin ich a disgrace. I found my goulashes and a package of matzes. It's my sugar, don't make sense. Oh, where is my pants?
So very clearly, I think for a Jewish audience, I don't think a mainstream audience would necessarily like get the joke about, I found my galoshes in my box of matzahs, whatever. But still, I think very, very, you know, very funny. All right, I want to end with a clip from Seinfeld. We were talking about Seinfeld last time, but I want to play an actual clip from Seinfeld today. There are so many episodes of Seinfeld that deal with clothing. Can anybody think of one that they want to put in the chat, or they want to unmute and mention it? Any Seinfeld fans here who can think
the
of
the man bra?
Okay, all right,
the
good.
The raincoat.
Right,
and then the puffy shirt.
The puffy shirt is one of my favorites. The puffy shirt is literally in the collection of the Smithsonian Museum in Washington, because the puffy pirate shirt that he goes on TV, and, you know, right. There's so many wonderful ones. This is an early one. The jacket, I think it very much brings us full circle. So that's why I wanted to play it.
Hey.
Hey, new jacket.
What do you think?
That's beautiful.
Is it me?
That's definitely you.
Really?
That's more you than you've ever been. Yeah. What is with the pink lining?
I don't know. It's got a pink lining.
So what'd you pay for this?
I paid what it costs.
How much?
What's the difference?
Well, you're not gonna tell me?
I'd rather not say it out loud. It's embarrassing.
Over 300?
Yes, but let's just stop it right there.
It's over 400.
Well, I'm not answering anyone.
Is it over 400?
Would you?
Whoa, Nilsson. This is huge. When did this happen?
Wednesday. This jacket has completely changed my life. When I leave the house in this, it's with a whole different confidence. Like tonight, I might have been a little nervous, but inside this jacket, I am composed, grounded, secure that I can meet any social challenge.
Can I say one thing to you? And I say this with an unblemished record of staunch heterosexuality.
Absolutely.
It's fabulous. And I'll tell you something else. I'm not even gonna ask you. I wanna know, but I'm not gonna ask. You'll tell me when you feel comfortable.
All right, I'm just gonna move it along a little bit.
What you paid for this jacket? Oh my God! $1,000? You paid $1,000 for this jacket. All right, I'm walking out of here right now thinking you paid $1,000 for this jacket unless you tell me different.
All right, just to explain, since we're just showing very short clips from this, so, you know, he buys this jacket for an incredible amount of money, and it's, you know, beautiful suede jacket, but it has this pink and white candy striped lining in the, you know, in the inside. And so, you know, it's about how everyone reacts in his social circle and whatever. But then he and George go to meet Elaine's father, who's a very tough army veteran. So, you know, they have a very awkward conversation with him, and then now they're going to go and walk out to a restaurant down the street.
It's beautiful.
Snow, that can't be good for suede, can it?
I wouldn't think so.
What should I do? We're taking a cab, aren't we?
Cab? It's only 5 blocks.
Why don't you turn it inside out?
Inside out, great.
Wait a minute. What the hell do you call this?
I turn my jacket inside out.
Well, you look like a damn fool.
Well, it's a new suede jacket. Might get ruined.
Well, you're not walking down the street with me and my daughter dressed like that. That's for damn sure.
It's only a few blocks.
Oh, what'd you do to it?
I was out in the snow last night.
You know what that does to suede?
I have an idea.
All right, so we're running out of time. So, but basically, I think what's really interesting about this, it sort of is reminiscent of the Fanny Bryce song, you know, in a way, right? This is like, there's one way in which he sort of wants to present himself to the world. And then there's the way that he feels inside, which the lining of the jacket symbolizes. And, you know, even though George says, you know, with an unblemished record of staunch heterosexuality, it looks great, you know, you can get away with it, you know, kind of thing. When it comes to Elaine's father, who sort of represents sort of more conservative values, you know, it's a real problem. And so I think this is the tension that we've kind of been exploring today, is the extent to which Jews have tried to really, you know, become American, become accepted, accept themselves, feel good about themselves, you know, through the clothing that they wear. And there's a wonderful episode of Curb Your Enthusiasm, which you may remember, with Hugh Hefner. And you know, Larry actually, it's called the smoking jacket. Larry borrows a, you know, a fancy smoking jacket from Hugh Hefner with, you know, like kind of a purple trim or something like that. Beautiful. He gives it back, and Hugh Hefner says to him, "This isn't the jacket that I lent you. This is some cheap Korean knockoff of the jacket that I lent you." And he says, "No, of course it's the same jacket. You know, I wouldn't substitute some like cheap Korean knockoff of this expensive jacket that you lent me." And, you know, so again, it's like this whole sense of like this theme of like being counterfeit in a way. Like, are Jews the real thing? Are they the authentic thing? Or are they the cheap Korean knockoff? And, you know, even as Jews have become so successful, and as we said at the beginning, become, you know, among the most successful fashioners, I mean, if you think about Ralph Lauren's designs and home furnishings and all that kind of thing, you know, this whole idea of polo, Ralph Lauren, you know, is really, really interesting. I mean, polo is like the most goyish, you know, I mean, this is really Ralphie Lifshitz from the Bronx, you know, who is reinventing himself and sort of reinventing America in the process, that we all have this aspiration to become these, you know, really kind of high class, waspy, you know, important people. But at the end of the day, you know, we're sort of still who we are. And I think it's very interesting that clothing still remains such an important thing in American comedy to this day. All right, we only have a couple minutes to go. So any
just two comments. One is it's funny, like Jews tend to be on the shorter side. So that Barbra Streisand song is funny, but the pants too long. The other thing is, you know, you see this in a lot of, my husband's a big fan of King of Queens and, you know, Seinfeld's around the same time. There's a lot of homophobia, or like subtle homophobia. It's almost as if the Jewish comics said, well, we can still make fun of people who are gay. And it's cringy sometimes to watch the anti-gay, or like, I'm not gay, you know, don't assume I'm gay. And it's almost like there has to be another scapegoat, you know, to take the brunt. Sorry, Judy, go ahead. I saw your hand up. Judy Korninsky, you got on mute.
I just wanted to say, going back to the very beginning, I had two aunts who weren't related, and they dressed their husbands and their sons in Brooks Brothers suits. That was the ultimate way to look like a goy.
But or a non-Jew, yeah.
Brothers, yeah.
Anyone else?
Yes, I'd like to make a comment. When you look at that, like the video with this, making the suit fit and all those things that really are funny to Jews, but I'm wondering, when non-Jewish people look at that, is it always comedic, or is it a way of saying, look at those cheap people, how they're trying to cheat somebody? I think there's a little bit of that might be going, that probably happens. I wonder if you could comment on that.
Yeah, no, it's a very good point. It's a very, very good point. And I think it's something that, you know, would probably be much more troubling nowadays for Jews to exhibit themselves in those days, in that way of, you know, exemplifying, you know, those kinds of anti-Semitic stereotypes.
I think it's also geographic. Margaret grew up in the South. You know, that wouldn't play in San Francisco. I think we're also, and I find myself falling in this trap a lot, I'm very Northeast focused. My whole point of reference is the Northeast. That would play in New York. I don't know if that would play in Indiana, and would be funny in Indiana. You know, Margaret's from the South, from Charlotte. So I think that's part of it too, is like who was watching this and who was laughing at this, and who would you never show this to?
Yeah, and there were, I mean, you know, I started out, you know, this whole, you know, line of research by looking at plays like AB's Irish Rose on Broadway from the 20s. And there were, you know, theater critics who, you know, basically said this is, you know, they were so anti-Semitic. And it was like accepted in those days, you know, for a theater critic to write about a Jewish play in the worst possible terms, like that these people should all be like, you know, like rounded up in a pogrom or something. I mean, they would, you know, I mean, the anti-Semitism was so deep that.
Well, in the government too. Yeah. Listen to Ultra. There's an amazing podcast, Ultra. We have to end, but there's a podcast, Ultra, about all the anti-Semitism in Senate and Congress. It's crazy. So that's why I just think about, like, you know, cross-eyed Jenny or whatever they call cock-eyed Jenny, and you know, the anti-gay stuff. It's like, you know, dad kicks mom and mom kicks the kids and the kids kick the dog. It's interesting psychology of it all. Ted is fabulous. Just a reminder, he is with us on Zoom next week, and then there will be no class on January 31st. Instead, I'm so excited. I'm actually not going to be in town, but Ted will be here for an event only for congregants, and it's we're calling it Senior Circle. All the circles are invited, all the Chavarot, on Sunday, January 29th, in person, about Jews in Delhi. I believe it's free. It's only for congregants, and it will have great deli, and Ted will be in person. You're a mentor across the screen, so I'm only sad that won't overlap with you, I think, in person, but just this, it'll be great. So that replaces class on January 31st, but he's with us next week. It's just such a joy to look at all this. Thank you, everyone. Aileen, thanks for starting us off and for producing. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.